Good morning, everyone. I'm Aditya Rajpakshe. Today, you all are here in the first day of EnPro series, Entry Part 1. This workshop series will help you to build a project correctly from the beginning to the end. Today, the workshop, which is Know Your Project, will show you how to differentiate among project types, and it will show you the best path for your project idea. So, let me welcome the guest speaker for today. It is my pleasure to welcome Mr. Kosala, Founding Director of Xavier, Electron LTD, Learning Enterprises LTD. Sir, I warmly welcome you to the webinar series. It is my pleasure to welcome all of our academy staff for the very first day of this webinar series. And here is a hearty welcome to RaIS Lab members, Next Gen members, and members of East Park Club, University of Sri Jayawardene. On behalf of the committee members, I wish all participants a warm welcome. This webinar series was organized by RaIS Lab in partnership with Next Gen and East Park Club members of University of Sri Jayawardene. Here is a small introductory video on those organizations. So now let's begin our workshop. Let me hand off the session to Dr. Dulini, Mudunkotuwa, Head of Department, Interdisciplinary Studies at Faculty of Engineering, University of Sri Jayawardene. Dr. Dulini, over to you.
Thank you, Aditya. It's an absolute pleasure to be with all of you today on our webinar series. And the first one is on Know Your Project Idea. And we have an eminent guest with us today to have this discussion. And let me properly introduce our guest today, Mr. Kosala Jayasundara, who needs no introductions at all, but let me do the formalities and introduce you anyway. Mr. Kosala Jayasundara is a graduate from Department of Electronics and Telecommunication of University of Moderator, and he also holds an MPhil from University of Moderator, and he holds MBA from Cardiff Metropolitan University, and he's a founding director of multiple companies, including high-tech solutions, Electron, Excel Tech Consulting, and many other companies. He has many years of experience in the industry, working for companies like MAS Innovations. He has experience in research and product development of electronics products in medical, marine, power, and wearable tech fields. And he has contributed to 6 international patents and many scientific publications. So we would like to warmly welcome Mr. Kosala Jayasundara for this webinar today. So to start this session, I would like to invite Mr. Kosala to share your experience with these students. So before we take a start to our topic, we would like to know more about your experience and how it can relate to knowing your project idea webinar series.
Thank you, Dr. Dulini, and it's a pleasure to share my ideas with you, and thank you very much for inviting for this session. About what I have gone through, initially I started from as an electronic engineer, but then I went into power electronics research. I did a kind of a core research in power electronic for electric vehicles. And then I started my own company, started developing products, sometimes electronic products, sometimes machineries. And again, that I did that for 10 years in high-tech solutions. And again, I joined MAS. There I did my wearable tech research and product development for automations in bulk manufacturing domain. And it's there I applied for a lot of international patents in products, not at the research level, but on products and applications. And now, on the last 2 years, I am working on my own company in two or three. One is in manufacturing, other is in local machinery and product development. Other one is in electronic product development for US and Europe market. So altogether, I have worked in core research, application research, and product development also. So I hope that I could share some thought with you that's useful in your projects.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kosala. So today we are talking about knowing the project idea. So I think before that, it's necessary for us to understand different stages of product development. There is research, and then there is translational research, and there is actual product development and commercialization. So Mr. Jayasundara, can you explain a little bit about these different types of research and translational research and product development? I think you are on mute, Mr. Kosala.
Sorry. So it's actually a really interesting topic, because when I was in undergraduate, we didn't have this kind of knowledge how to differentiate between the projects, research types. The difference in here is that in basic research, you are talking about improving the world's knowledge base in different aspects and sharing that with all the other researchers and other communities. So we are talking about high-level research that no one else has done, or improvement from what they have done, and ending normally with a paper, international paper, maybe journal paper, and sharing what you have learned with everyone else. So the purpose of basic research project is to add some value to the already available knowledge base. So when you are publishing a paper especially, they are checking whether your paper is novel. That means whether you are adding anything more to the known knowledge. That's the idea. So in this way, you are not talking about a product, you are not talking about taking something into the market, you are not talking about the cost of making this product. It's just the basic product and basic research and adding some knowledge to the knowledge base. That's the main purpose of doing basic research. Doesn't matter the field, whether you are in chemistry, electronics, civil, whatever thing, you are adding to the known knowledge base. That's the basic research level product projects. And translation research is getting something you have already in the knowledge base and converting that to a useful application domain, not as an application. In translation research, for an example, you can make a prototype of something from an old knowledge. Say you have you have some new type of solar panel chemistry designed by another researcher, and you are getting it and making a solar panel prototype. So it's not a product. You might not be selling it out, but it's converting a knowledge base into a physical product base. So it's called translational research. The purpose of that is different. You may actually publish some paper. It might not be novel, but it's actually conversion. So you might not be adding anything new to the total knowledge base, but you are converting the non-knowledge base into a product domain that someone can copy your research and develop it to a physical product. So that's called translational research. And the last type is the product development. In product development, you are not talking about any new inventions. You are not inventing a new chemistry, you're not inventing new prototype, sorry, solar panel technology. You're not inventing any new like basic core research. It's just getting all these non-knowledges, non-prototypes, and then converting into a physical product that you are selling in the market. So the idea of product development is to get something out which is needed by the customer, needed by the consumer, which is profitable to make, and making sure that it lasts a given timeline. If you need it to last for 1 year, you have to make sure that it lasts for 1 year. And if it is made for like a smartwatch that you can wear in the underwater, it should be waterproof. So all these consumer type requirement should be implemented in the product development. It's totally different, and normally product developers don't end with the paper. You can publish a paper, but it's not the requirement. Normally these product developments end with the consumer product that actually sells. And sorry, I forgot about the translation research. In translation research, that normally ends with the patent. In translation research, you have something tangible and you can patent that thing. I developed a special type of solar panel using this technology, and this development is patent to me. So the initial basic research normally ends with a journal paper that you share with everyone else. Translational research normally ends with a patent that owns this technology to you, that you can sell to other product development companies. And product development normally ends with the physical product that you can sell. That's the difference between all these three, as I see.
Right. Thank you very much, Mr. Kosala. And I'm sure this product development is done in different ways in different countries. So I would like to know a bit about how the process works in Sri Lanka before we discuss about what happens in other countries. In your experience, can you tell us a bit about how this product development is done in currently in Sri Lanka, especially in these tech products?
Sorry, again, I was in mute. So honestly, in Sri Lanka, we are not kind of an expert product development country. So the knowledge in this area is really lacking. We are good in agriculture, we are good in textile manufacturing, we are good in all the tea rubber industries, we are good in software, but developing physical products is not the expertise we have in the country. So as a result, our product development journey, our product development process is really immature, to be honest. So as a result, what we see as really good inventions, innovations, and the good inventors is not the people who are taking actually something into the physical market. That's why we don't have the companies like Apple, Samsung, Huawei. We don't have big companies like that, not even fixed names. We had some, like, if you can remember, Upali, they had really good companies in, they manufactured unique radios, cars and everything. The current portfolio of those kind of companies is lacking. Honestly, I can't remember, like, remind a few. Dumbo is a really good product development company, and Orange is doing a really good job. Vega is trying to enter the market, and likewise, and Micro is trying to do a job. So likewise, we have some companies coming in, but over the large amount of years, we didn't do it correctly. As a result, we don't have good products coming out from Sri Lanka. The current process in Sri Lanka is that people confuse between prototype and product. When you want to make a prototype, you go on your own intuition. You think that this is the product to the market, and you just build it up and try to sell without any testing and reliability enhancement. And as a result, these products fail. And the bigger problem is, as we don't have that kind of knowledge base within the country, our speculations about the cost, market share, and everything is wrong. So when you get an investment with the wrong specification, you can't put into the actual production because it's like mess in a way, because the investment is not enough, your timeline is not correct, and your final product specifications are not what actually customers need. As a result, in Sri Lanka, normally products fail in the middle. That's what we have seen over and over again over these last many years. You might have seen so much of product innovations like these car, like coming in the market, like new cars, new like whatever, solar-driven vehicles, new products and everything, but nothing comes down to the bulk manufacturing phase. That's the biggest problem in Sri Lanka. Normally, we can do small things like switch gears, small electronics. We can do, but not proper products that's selling in international market. Except Damro, I don't know, like there are few, but not in huge volumes. So that's the problem in Sri Lanka. We don't execute correct product development, and we normally think it as either translational projects or research projects. So we end up with good prototypes, but it's not manufacturable either, or it's not needed from the consumers. That's the current status of Sri Lanka, unfortunately. And I'm honestly thinking that you are getting something out of this lecture that you can change the way that you are developing the products. And internationally, as Dr. Dulini suggested, I can give two examples from two sides of the world. One is China, where they make quick product developments, quick and cheap product developments in large scale. And other side is US, where they manufacture really high-end products. It takes a large amount of time to develop this kind of product, but it's like in China, they might have like 200 different phone types, but US might have one or two phone types. But again, that's a different way of manufacturing high-end products. So these two product development cycles differ hugely. One way is in China, like if I can explain about the Chinese product development method, they just get some intuition from a very limited amount of customers and develop it at a very short time using a very shorter manufacturing, like development expense. They don't focus much on reliability, focus much on the optimization or the customer's requirement at GUI and everything. They just manufacture something simple, and they manufacture it in large quantities. Also, they don't go for complex research and innovation part. They just put something which is available in the market and put it to the bulk production. As a result, when you develop something in Chinese product development way, it's mostly not user-friendly, but it's cheaper and can be manufactured in large scale. You can see it in most of their products. If you just compare, like, the best comparison is smartwatches. So when you get smartwatches in China, you can purchase, even in Sri Lanka, you can purchase smartwatches at 1,500 rupees. So there are a huge amount of different types of smartwatches. They are cheaper, but they are not the best in the functionality, and they are not the best in the usefulness, because they didn't go to the consumers and like work with them for 1 year to get the correct consumer demand. In the other side, Korea, Japan, and US, they manufacture really high-end smartwatches, which takes a huge amount of money and time to develop. And the price is really high. Normally, you can purchase maybe Apple smartwatch at 100,000 rupees, but still that also sells. So there are two different ways of product development. First, you have to identify what type of product you are developing and which market and into which price scale. Then you can select whether it's a Chinese method or US method. So the first thing is to use Chinese method, where you are making a quick prototype. Make sure that costing is smaller, but it doesn't mean that it's easier or it's like low tech. The Chinese manufacturing method is different. It's not low tech, of course. They are going for sometimes the highest tech components to make sure that the cost is lower. Sometimes it's even harder than manufacturing a really high-end product, because you have to make sure that you can sell the smartwatch at 1,500 rupees, which is probably your manufacturing cost is only 800 rupees, so 700 rupees, even lesser. Should be, if it is 1,500 at mark retail, it should be 500 rupees, which is around $2, $2 to $3. At $2 to $3, you can't even make a case in Sri Lanka. So they are manufacturing and doing it everything, which is really hard, but they are choosing that part. So that's one of the parts we can do, make a quicker and cheaper product output. In that kind of cheaper development cycle, you have to make a large amount of products because you don't know what is going to succeed. You are not going for the consumer manager or anything. And that gives you a sub-performance devices at lower cost. That's one way of developing. And honestly, if you have seen some products like Huawei and Xiaomi, they are having really good products, which is compatible with US products. Then for these companies, they are following the same way that US is following, which is really good research and development, and then going for the consumer analysis, getting the correct behaviors, and then selling it at high end. That's also possible. So it's not to say that China is doing only cheap products. They are having really high end products, but I am talking about the two ways of developing. One is low cost, low timeline development. The other one is what US, Japan, and Korea is doing. Normally what they do is they spend a huge amount of money to optimize the product and make sure that you are going for the correct consumer requirement, and then find out the best components in the market and going for a high-end, high-value product, which is totally different from what China is doing. Normally, I will focus a bit more on that part because I don't think that we can compete anyway with that Chinese manufacturing method. The reason is not that we don't have any technology or anything. All this manufacturing or product development has nothing to do with technology. It's about the resource you have and the suitability to the country. So for an example, China has a really good ecosystem where they can purchase components at 1/3 the price than anyone else. I have done a research about that before. When I say NMAs, how they are manufacturing at that kind of lower price. The reason is when you go to China, when you go to Shenzhen, there are components that you can't export. Chinese government doesn't allow you to export these components. They are 1/3 of the price. Their quality is not good. They are manufactured in Chinese foundries and they have huge failure rates, but still it's 1/3 of the price. So if you, for an example, the cheapest microcontroller you can purchase with the analog input is around 18 cents. USD, like it was at mail at tiny microcontroller, but the cheapest that Chinese can purchase from Shenzhen is 6 cents. It's 1/3 the price what we can purchase from anywhere in the world. And that microcontroller doesn't have any other language. Even it's programmed in Chinese and everything is in Chinese, you can't export that. So that's a market we can't normally tap into. What we can do is to go to European market. Type product development, which is easier for us because the European type product development requires a large amount of human resource. That means the engineering hours is huge. For that, we have an advantage from Sri Lanka because our engineering hours is much lesser. Engineering hour cost is much lesser. So I can just share one slide. I don't want to go through slides or anything in this, but to give an idea about how they are doing. They normally have a common process for product development. This process, like this is what we are following in our company also, I just put it on. But what they do is they go for business requirement document first and make sure that you properly get the business requirement. What the like waterproofing glass, what the battery size, what's the size of the product, and what how long it should last, and what's the user requirement, how the buttons are arranged, everything from top to bottom in a document before even they start developing anything. Normally, that's something we never do in Sri Lanka. Normally, we start with developing the prototype and then think about whether it matches the consumers. It's the same thing that China is also doing. But what these high-end manufacturers like Apple, Samsung, Sony, what they are doing is they spend a huge amount of time in developing the business requirement, going to the consumers, talk to them, work with them, and then finding out what's the exact requirement for these business sector. Then they go for a proper documentation process. This is the documentary process I normally follow and most of the other companies in Europe follow, US follow, but you can change it, but it's common. Like you have business requirement document and then go for design basis document and go for design reviews and then only do the design and do prototyping. So the prototyping comes at least 6-7 months after the start of the project. And then you test it and make sure that the technology is okay. And then there is a specific bulk scale-up phase, normally which runs for 1 year. So after your prototyping is okay, everything is okay, it takes one more year for the product to go to the market because you have a lot of testing prototypes to be done, and then you have to make sure that large amount of testing is done to make sure that it doesn't break on the way. If you remember what happened to Galaxy Note 7, which was catching fire in the planes and everywhere, it just read about it. Then you can identify how complex this process is. The reason for Galaxy Note 7 was that it didn't do enough testing. They might have done testing on maybe 1,000 or 2,000 phones, but it was not enough to identify that error. If they did around 5,000, 10,000 testing with the phones, they could have identified that error. So likewise, you need to do a test of huge amount of devices. I have seen marketing the product doing testing on 1,500 pieces. So they set up a large amount of chairs and testing bits, and they were running that device with 1,500 samples. All these 1,500 samples are going into the dustbin after this testing, but they were doing it to make sure that their product is perfect. So likewise, you have to make sure that you are following a different set of steps and getting the correct certification. If you are selling to US and Europe, you need CE, FCC, UL, maybe FDA, that kind of certifications, and taking all these certifications take a long time. So this is the process that US is following. They are slow, but they are making sure that a perfect product comes out from their side. So I wanted to explain the two side of it, but not to make you confused or anything. But before you start your product development, you have to select one of these two. Either it's a Chinese type one, either it's a Europe type one. And then focus on how you can optimize that too. Because if you go into that kind of high-end production and everything, you can't go for cheaper product. So if you are going for very cheap mass market product, you can't go for that second type. You have to always follow the first type, which is Chinese type. So make sure that you know about what you are developing and what consumer market and what's the price range before you start developing this.